Hey, tonight's show marks the third time that we've selected one of their recordings as our Shindig Pick of the Week. And when you hear this one, I'm sure you're going to agree there really was no other choice besides Unchained Melody by Bobby Hatfield of the Righteous Brothers.
Oh, my love, my darling, I've hungered for your touch a long, lonely time.
What's up, everybody? This is the second episode of Reconsidered, a podcast where we want to bring attention and awareness to topics and things and ideas that people take for granted, right?
Absolutely.
And, you know, just kind of bring awareness to that so that people can get new perspectives on those topics, ideas.
Whatever. I think it's valuable to think about things in a new way, right? So to get somebody else's perspective on something that they haven't heard of, or maybe they have heard of and want to hear something new about it. Something that is like, that can change the way that they view the world in a better way, right? Knowledge is power, but actually taking that knowledge and putting it into action is even more powerful. So
yeah, I'm excited about today's episode.
And our guest.
Because of our guest, I'm going to say your full name. Riaan Garforth-Venter.
It's kind of a mouthful.
It is, but Riaan is from South Africa. He's been in America for over a year now, right? About a year and a half-ish, somewhere around there. He's going to come in and talk about a lot of awesome topics that, you know, not everybody here in the States would consider.
That's a good way to put it. Yeah. I mean, moving from another country puts you in a whole other perspective than anybody around you once you move.
Right, so this is going to be a big one. This is going to be a lot of things to reconsider. And so, so what's up, Riaan? How are you?
I'm good.
Good.
I'm good. Nice to be with you, Riley, and nice to be with you, Ethan.
Welcome to the show, man.
Riaan and I actually worked together. We just started working together 2 weeks ago.
Only 2 weeks? I didn't realize it was so soon.
Yeah, it's 2 weeks. Yeah, I started on the 1st of November.
Yeah. First of November, Riaan comes up to Atlanta Coffee Supply Group, helped out in the warehouse tremendously. We expanded our space. He completely organized it.
Yeah, I heard in like you guys said, in 4 days, the whole warehouse is just like completely redone.
Yeah, one huge 100% change.
Riaan has some cool special skills. He's a master carpenter.
Yeah, I am. Yeah.
And in South Africa, he had a TV show. And how many episodes did you film?
Yeah, so in South Africa, I had a TV show for the last 15 years. I've done about 600 episodes of TV where I work with my hands. I'm a carpenter, but I saw the thing 15 years ago that all the youngsters of South Africa, and I think youngsters all over the world, they can't all be advocates and doctors, and they need to work with their hands, because people who build a country, and I think that's what we're doing in America now, we're building a country,
right?
And people working together, you'll always have your people that's got to work with their hands. And
And
I build this brand in South Africa. It was called DIY with Riaan. My name is spelled R-I-A-A-N.
You're lucky it just rolls off the tongue.
Oh, yeah.
DIY with Riaan.
Well, that's it. So, hopefully you will see my name more, because I also want to do like a wood factory called Riaan's Creations one day. And I'm so, so very happy to be in America. It's quite cool to be here. I left everything back in South Africa, all that fame that I had. You know, my wife and I were both very famous in South Africa. She had a wildlife show like the Steve Irwin of Australia that was killed.
The crocodile hunter?
The crocodile hunter. Yeah. My wife was the same. She was bitten by a cheetah.
Whoa.
What?
So if people go to YouTube and they Google there, cheetah bite, Michelle Garforth.
Oh,
they will see the whole attack of a cheetah on her arm. So
wow. We've
been filming that. We did all of that TV shows in South Africa. I was also Michelle's film man. I did the camera work, all the underwater stuff. We dived with sharks. I mean, there's a lot of stuff I'm going to tell you guys and keep you happy for years. But that's in a small background what my wife and I did. We got married in April of next year. We'll be married 9 years. We've got a little boy of 6 years old. His name is Rain, like the rain that falls out of the
earth. That is awesome.
Yeah,
awesome.
And we did the whole thing that we're going to talk about life today. It's about why did I come to America?
Right.
Yeah, and what it's been like since then.
Yeah.
So let's do your little prelude chapter.
Mm-hmm.
You did something that pretty much nobody else in South Africa did.
Yeah.
When you got married, you took your wife's last name also, and conjoined your names together. Many women in America will keep their last name and then add on, you know, their husband's name. But husbands don't do that, vice versa.
They don't do that, because I think men are so
stubborn.
Stubborn is a good word.
Ego,
you know,
egotistical.
The ego, just like, you know, the Clinton must always be a Clinton, or you know, there's never going to be the Clinton Ethans or the Clinton whatever you're going to add onto it. Because the man wants to be so strong. But in short, in South Africa, what happened is I was Riaan Venter. How would you say Venter?
It's Venter.
Venter.
Yeah.
Like Venter.
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 Riaan Venter. And my wife was Michelle Garforth. Very English. She's very English. She's the English Rose. You know?
Mm-hmm.
The beauty and the beast. But and when we got married, you know, and I knew this is going to be... This is my love of my life. I want to be with this woman. And why can I also, you know, just, why does a woman always have to take the husband's wife and then they get divorced, you know, then there's this whole thing going on. And I said, but I love you so much that I will actually take your last name as well.
Mm-hmm.
And we were the first couple in South Africa of 55 million people. I went through, I changed my passport. I changed my, we've got an ID document like your driver's licenses. And we changed everything, and my name is now Garforth-Venter. Venter.
So let me ask you, was it debatable at first between you and your wife whether it would be Venter Garforth or Garforth-Venter? Was that ever a question?
You know what? I thought about it. We met, and one day we chatted among friends like what we're doing now, and it just came like, you should become Garforth-Venter.
Mm-hmm.
And it sticked. It never was Venter Garforth. We thought about it and thought, okay, alphabetically the G is before the V,
right.
So maybe it works that
right,
way.
Right.
I think it sounds better too.
It does.
But it just always was what it is.
Yeah, so that was the first for me in South Africa. So that's what you've got here today. You've got a guy that loves life and work together and make something beautiful. Yeah.
That's really cool.
That's excellent.
I like that prelude. All right, Riley, you want to take us into our second segment?
Sure. Like, as far as what you planned, right? It's like, when you came up with the idea, well, first we have to kind of discuss, like, what led you to start even thinking about moving to America?
Yeah.
So you were doing this DIY show. You got it, you know, you're doing all these, like, 600 episodes. It seems very successful, you know? And then, but something had to have happened where something clicked in your mind where you wanted to...
Yeah.
To the States. So what, like, if you can think about it, when was like the first time you really can remember considering moving to the States? What were you doing? At what point were you in the DIY show? Was it before and you waited 15 years?
No, I mean, it's a big decision to leave your country.
Right.
I mean, for everybody. I think that, and I also feel everybody that leaves his country has got to have guts, you know,
mm-hmm.
guts to do it. Because it's not everybody that packs his stuff up and jump on a plane and say, okay, I'm done with my country. Because, you know, I'm the age of 50 years. So I lived in my country for 50 years. I see the beauty of my country. I love my country. I mean, the animals and the beautiful place that we have there. And you, and I got my family, you know, my mom is like 11 kids. I've got 120 cousins and I've got nieces. I mean, I've got huge families in South Africa. I did very well in South Africa, becoming a TV celebrity, you know.
Yeah.
Everything is good, you know, it's good. And so, and I've got two daughters there. My one daughter is 24 years old. She's a chef in South Africa, pastry chef. And she might immigrate to Sweden next year, also for the same reasons, which we will hear why I got the decision. And then also, I've got another daughter of 21 years who's in a fourth year. She's doing a master's at the university in social living, you know, and to help people that's poor. And this is a social worker. Social worker.
That's awesome.
So that's what she's studying to become, you know.
Yeah.
So then you've got to make the decision and say, my mom is still there, my brother is still there, so you've got to have balls to leave the country.
Right,
and that's it. So when do you make that decision? You know, you make that decision, I think, when you lie in your bed with a gun against your head, tied up assassin style. You know, they tied me up with... So what I'm trying to tell you is that we were invaded into our house. You know, Michelle and I was in 2010, on the 6th of December in 2010, they invaded our house with was three guys. One stayed outside and they... I was undressed, completely naked. They tied me down with ties and metal straps on my bed. And my wife was lying next to me. And I thought it was the last day of my life. You know, it's like they put the gun against my head. They hit me with a 9mm over my head. And you lie there looking into your wife's eyes and you think, okay, so this is how you die. Because have any of you ever thought how you're going to die?
No,
you know, because...
No, like
We don't think about that things in life. You know, you just want to live your life and have a beautiful life. That's what I feel. That's why we are born, is to have a beautiful life. That's
mm-hmm.
what it is. And here I'm lying, and I thought my son has already been killed because they said to me, oh, you got a beautiful son. And my boy was like 5 months old, and I never heard him crying again. You know, and I just gave him a bottle, and they came to my house at 1:30. In the morning, and they left me at like 5:30, and luckily didn't kill me because I'm also an army veteran, as I can negotiate myself out of this whole situation, how to get out of it. And then you decide, you know what, I can't stay in this country anymore. You know, you can't barbecue with a gun in your pocket
mm-hmm.
or walk around in your house. Is that? And luckily for my side, which other people don't have, is that Michelle is an American citizen. So she came to America in 96. And she lived in Los Angeles for 10 years to become a citizen. And, you know, she always said to me, I want to go back. But we had a beautiful life, you know. Our life was great. We had this, everything, you know, everything is going well. We got the cars and the houses. And then you just decided, but life is so important. You know, cars and houses and stuff isn't that important in life anymore. So that was when I made my mind up, that was 6 years ago, to say, okay, I'm done with it. I've got to get out. But then you've got to start working on your brain and this transition to your family that you want to start getting out. That's what you do. So I think that's where you get to the thought. But what I want, and that's why in 2010 I said, okay, I'm making this point, I've got to get out of this country. And then what also happened, politics became so bad and corruption became so bad that this beautiful country of mine are actually just falling to pieces. You know, they kill the rhinos, you know, and they can't stop it. The Chinese come in and they kill rhinos and they cut their horns off and they shoot them by the thousands. I mean, they're going to, in a year from now, if they carry on like this, there ain't going to be more rhinos in this world anymore. But the government, just let it go, you know, and you just get to a point like, where is this going to stop? Is South Africa... was based on American dream when everybody started building America, and we made a first world country of South Africa and Africa, and now suddenly this whole place is just going backwards and backwards, and you know, and it's Africa, that's all what it is, and I'm not, it's okay, but you must still, if you get something, you must look after it, and if you can't stay in your country anymore, you can't stay there,
mm-hmm.
and that's the big mind up that you've got to do.
I definitely don't blame you for... taking that.
That's a lot. That's heavy.
Heavy
on the heart, man.
Heavy on the heart.
When you just drop the song,
it's very heartful.
Yeah, I had no idea.
It takes a lot of courage for you to go through that.
So
yeah.
Can I ask you, was it just criminals or were they military?
No, they were criminals.
Did they know that you were essentially famous?
I don't think so. But because when in the morning when the police arrived and that they... I got cards, you know, my fan cards.
Right.
And they threw that out of my bag, and I think they realized that I'm a TV star.
Right.
And they left, you know, but yeah, they cleaned me well up, you know. What they do, they hand you, and you've got to open up the safe, and they take all your watches and your monies and your laptops and, you know, your cell phones. And usually they kill people for that. You know, they kill people
right.
for a cell phone. But I don't want to talk bad about quality, though, because we're building a life. And that's why I'm here for, is to live my dream. I think America is it's the most unbelievable place to live in. And I think people living here don't realize what they have. It could be Hillary and it could be Trump. It's all these things going on. But you know what? You still have no fences around your houses.
Mm-hmm.
You can still, mom with their kids can still walk down the road with prams. And yeah, I mean, it's just normal life for you.
Right.
This isn't normal. It feels to me, if I'm like, I don't know what, you know, I don't use drugs, but I don't know if it's acid or whatever the old, but I just feel on this cloud because every day is just a beautiful experience.
Just for it.
What I
right.
get in this country. I mean, meeting you guys.
Yeah,
it's great for me, you know.
That's
as good. Guys, I like the new technology. I like the way young people think. You know? And sometimes you think about older people, you know, where's the young? I love this, you know, because we're in a technology life, which it's computers and it's a new growth what we do. And if we as older people don't latch onto younger guys, we're going to stay behind, man.
Yeah. Right.
You know, people, they're so quick to say, youngsters do this, but
you're
such
it seems
a
like you're enlightened.
Hey?
You're at the final stage of life. You're clearly enlightened.
Oh, man.
It's
not the
why.
Final. Beauty of it is that he's still accepting everything and growing. Like, everything's new to him.
Yes.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yes.
And I think that is what a point of enlightenment is that you accept that you don't know everything and that you want to continue to learn and absorb and get
everything.
To that point where you understand and you're with and a part of everything, but you're happy and you don't have threats to your
nothing,
life.
Nothing.
You don't have any threats.
Yeah.
Wow.
That's beautiful. I could drive to not in the freeway.
You were there for So you were there for 5 years before you moved.
Yeah, for 5 years. But what I did then is that because of my TV business that I got, reason of politics, I also didn't want white people on South African TV anymore. I mean, I can talk to you guys about this now. They don't want any more white people. So I lost my job being a presenter on the national TV, same as Michelle. They said, no more white people. So then I had to go and say, okay, what do I do now? So I found another channel, which is a very poor, not a poor, pure television for white people, you
right.
know, Dutch speaking, we call it Afrikaans speaking, and I'm also, I've got another language, and I went to that, but you know what, I like teaching the masses, because my whole life that I had in South Africa is I taught people to work with their hands.
Right, you gave them a tangible skill to build something.
Yes, not only people with money that can afford cable and
change.
Yeah.
Talk about change, actually building something,
yes.
creating something that's new. That's what our podcast is about.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, the things that I've done in South Africa, another thing is that I work with a guy called Neil Mellon. He's from Ireland. And I built 200 with 1,400 Irish men and women. And I was the presenter on a show. It's called Our House, and we built 200 houses in 10 days.
Wow,
that's astonishing!
Brick houses with tile roofs, everything. So it was a whole thing that we did.
Is it like affordable housing?
Affordable housing,
yeah.
And we gave it to poor people, and that's what I also did in South Africa. So
that's awesome.
Yeah, it's awesome to live all these things. I don't know, I'm even completely off my story, but. There's so many things that I can tell you, and that's why you got to enjoy America. Let's get back to it, because living in a free country, it's unbelievable. So that's what I said. Now I've got to pack everything up. You know, I did this one TV show, and I said to Michelle, you know, I can't do this. This is not what I want to do. So we sold one of our houses in Johannesburg, and we moved down to the East Coast, and I opened up a hardware store. So I bought a hardware store. I like changing things. What I do with Riley at the warehouse, that's what I do. I'm an entrepreneur.
Right.
I like it. So I bought this hardware store, quickly turned around, sell it again. And then I moved a friend, and then I said to Michelle, and then we made a decision in June 2014. We made a decision, we're leaving.
Mm-hmm.
That's the date of we're leaving, okay? So now you've got to start with your green card. It's a very big process doing a green card. But my blessing is that Michelle was an American citizen. So it took me a year to get my green card. You had to go through all the ropes. And a year later, I got my green card. And now I've got it. So now what do we do now? You know, it's
right.
like a dog running after a car. You know, he runs after the car and he gets in the car and he goes like, what now?
Right.
The
dog chasing the mailman.
Yeah. Now the mailman is the same
thing.
So now I've got my green card. And what do I do now? You know, I spent all this money. Now it's I'm going, and now I've got to tell my mom and all of this.
That seems like a pretty fast like time to get your green card in 1 year.
Oh, that's unbelievable.
That's unbelievable.
But it's, because the only reason is the marriage to Michelle, because she's American citizen.
Right.
Awesome.
Right.
Yeah.
That's super fortunate.
So, so when you started your process in 2013?
2014, June 2014.
When you started.
Yes.
And then
the green card process.
Right. So in 2015, you got your card, and then you moved?
No, then I got, what now? Where do we go in America?
Oh, yeah.
Where do we go, you know? So we decided, okay, Michelle said no ice, no snow. Okay, we want something warm. So she said Florida, Tampa, Charleston, Orlando. But, you know, no Georgia. That, you know, we don't know this area. So our best friend, Roger Lewis, who's a dentist in California, he was Michelle's dentist, and we became very good friends over this 10 years. He flew to my wedding in South Africa, which I will tell you one day about. But I had wild animals for my wedding. So an elephant brought Michelle.
That's so beautiful.
I will give, and I had all of that stuff. That's we had zebras around us, and then we got married in the bush. But in any case, so Roger came down.
That's awesome.
And we said, listen, we got this green card. We've got to make a decision. Do we go or not? And he said, listen, guys, I'm retiring into Atlanta, and he retired on the 24th of June, of May, and we landed on the 26th of May.
Wow.
And here the two of us, and he said, just come and check this place out. So we came here, we stayed here for a week, went to Orlando, went to Tampa, came back to say and said, listen, this is where we want to live.
Wow.
And we made a decision. So now there's a big one. Now you've got to tell your mom and your dad and dad, all of them. Yeah, and so we flew back to South Africa. It took us 4 months to pack up. I had to sell my other two houses, sell my car, sell the other car, sell my tools. You know, I was sponsored with tools by Bosch. You know Bosch tools?
Those are the best tools.
Yeah, but I had so much. I had truckloads of tools because they always sent me the newest tools. So I gave that to my brother. He's got a lot of tools because it's all 220 volt where you've got 110 volt in America. You know, all those things. I can't use my plugs and the lights doesn't work. So you can't bring anything. So we packed a 30 feet container.
Yeah.
Packed that, but what we want. So we took all our memories. We got boxes of books that we've written. I've written three books as well about woodwork and eco-living. So I've got three books. I'll bring it to you next time to discuss if you want to.
Definitely.
Michelle written a book. And so we packed our memories, all our photos. We've got lots and lots of tape, you know, stock that you can make a movie of. We've got all the wildlife shows, all my TV shows. I also got a car show. I built a 1941 Chev. I also built old cars.
Really?
Yeah.
What's your favorite American made?
You know what, I'm in this whole point because I've decided that I'm going to build a car for Rain.
Okay.
Cool.
And I'm a Mustang fan.
Oh, Mustang. So Shelby Cobra.
Yeah.
It's not the Mustang, but it's Shelby Cobra.
Yeah, so I've got I bought myself a Mustang convertible, a 214, the nice. I mean, it's a dream for me to have that because you can't afford it in South Africa.
Yeah.
It's a full import. So,
that's a beautiful car.
So it costs you like $140,000 in South Africa. And here you buy you can buy it for $13,000,
yeah,
you know, $10,000. So I think that's what I want to build. I'm looking for an old Mustang.
Mustang.
I think a 69. That's the
magic number.
Yeah,
69, beautiful year.
Yeah.
Beautiful year.
I don't want the 65, the 69. So that's what I did. So we made a decision, packed our things, put our container on a ship, got on the plane, and we arrived here on the... on the 6th of October 2015. So I've been here more than a year now, a year and a month. And I love this country still, like every day. And it's just for me, it's a privilege to be here. And I hope that with the little sayings that some Americans will go like, yeah, man, we got a beautiful country here. You got a great place.
It is beautiful.
Don't moan about a little racist stuff and just get over it and let's carry on in life and decide to have a good life, you know.
I
we must
that.
Stop with this.
Yeah. Well, one thing that I've been able to see just throughout this conversation is, you know, like you were talking about taking things for granted that we can do, like drive down the freeway. Like you were saying, when you leave here, you'll be able to drive down the freeway.
Yeah.
You'll have a fence, you know, around your house that isn't one that you put up at a wood picket fence or something. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, and that's making me reconsider a lot of things that I take for granted.
Yeah. Unless,
so if I'm reconsidering things, I know people that are going to be listening are definitely going to be able to reconsider.
I thank God every day for what
yeah.
I have.
Yeah.
You know, and if it's not God, I'm thanking the universe,
yeah.
whatever you want to call it.
Whatever you want to call it.
I'm
right.
so thankful for the
yeah.
awesome house that I live in.
Yeah.
The friends that I have. Right? The safety. Like,
safety.
I know that I could go walk through my neighborhood, I could walk to the store and do what I want.
Yes.
And I don't have to worry about anything. And that's such a simple, basic human need.
Human.
And
so
I couldn't imagine living in another country for 4 years with something like that happening to me. And knowing that I, like, could leave.
Yeah.
Like, when that happens, like you said, that was the moment. The instantaneous
yeah.
second where you were like, I have to get out of here.
Yeah.
To do that, it would make it a lot easier to move to another country. and you know, we're you know, curious to see
yeah.
why you moved. And to be honest, I thought it was going to be a much normaler answer, right? Something that I could have come up with.
Yeah, you dropped a bombshell on
it. I could not, you know,
yeah.
that was
can't
amazing.
Can't even fathom living in
yeah.
South
that,
Africa and going to do that.
Yeah,
like,
but it's
I just persevered. Is this,
yeah.
my brother, you know, more power to you, brother.
That's what I have. There's other people that don't, but I would say 90% of people leaving South Africa now is because of that reason.
Yeah.
And 100% leave it because of corruption and crime.
So do you know anybody else that has left South Africa now?
You know what?
Like anybody that you knew before?
Yes, no, definitely. There's a lot of South Africans going to New Zealand. It's very difficult to get into America.
New Zealand's beautiful. My girlfriend's family's from New Zealand.
Yeah. So
well,
it's easier for the South Africans to go there and also to Australia. American is very, is more difficult. You've got to have family and you know, otherwise you wait like 8 to 10 years
yeah.
for a green card. It's
right.
not, and it's good. It's good.
New Zealand's like you have to earn the citizenship there.
Yeah.
Prove that you're a good, you know, citizen. Good
yeah.
person. It's intense.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
So one thing that you were talking about that we've talked about a lot is your entrepreneurial spirit, right?
Yeah.
And so you're trying to start a new thing. You said Riaan's Creation. So you had your TV show before, but now you don't really want to be in the spotlight, the limelight. You just want to do it.
That's
right,
it.
And then bring other people on board with you, and just build cool things,
yes.
which I think is an awesome idea.
And teach people normal things in life. I just did a treehouse for a friend today on the farm, and it's just putting paneling in. You know, for me, it's like I can do it with my eyes closed.
Right,
you know?
Right.
And then they all stand there and go like, "Why?" And I go like.
And you did it so fast because you just know how to do it.
I just know how to do it. So
and
I would
so
love to give this to other people.
To just share that with somebody
yeah.
else too.
Yeah.
And something that you probably don't even realize is that you just have a process. So you know whether you get out your tools or you get out the material first, right? And you
yeah.
know what goes up and how to build the wall and where you put, you know, the base on and then you line up the boards and then you just start, you know,
yeah.
making it, right?
The whole life works in the process.
And exactly.
The whole
world
is a
makes
process.
It efficient. Right,
yeah.
and makes it continue to go smoothly.
Yeah,
right, and that's cool. So the reason you were able to build 200 houses in 10 days was because you guys had a process.
Yes,
and it was just it was already planned out.
No, you plan it. Planning is very important to anything that you do.
It's just as important as actually doing it.
Yeah,
and we were talking about this in our previous episode where it's like. It's not just about like executing something. You have to execute it well, right? And to do that, there's stuff behind it. And whether you're creating art and it's like the purpose or the passion or the idea that you're trying to convey, or whether it's, you know, a building and you have the purpose, but then you have to figure out how you're actually going to do it. So it's cool to think about, you know, there's a process of building or of painting something and of building a treehouse,
yeah.
right? And I like that aspect of what I've learned today.
You know, to bring just now you said you know you believe in a God or in a universe, and I had a saying one day to me. You know, it's like I rather live the life, you know, of a good person. For if there's a hell or a heaven up there, maybe and if because we will never know. At least I was a good person
yeah,
in the
right.
world, and I will go to heaven. Rather love that. But if it's not there, it's also cool.
Right.
Right. At least it's gonna be cool then. And whatever happens,
legacy.
As a positive legacy you want to leave here. to do that, yeah.
I think the measure of a man is the positive influence and impact that he has on those around him, right?
Yeah.
Doesn't matter how small or how great that is, but as long as it's positive and you're helping other people continue to succeed or just get better in life and live a better life, live a safer life, live a happier life,
yeah.
whatever that may be for that person. Because everything is situational and relative.
Yeah.
Giving good influence.
Yeah.
You know?
And perception.
And perception. And not knowing how much it's going to impact doesn't really matter, you know, because it could impact a little bit, or like you were just saying. But either way, you're impacting.
Right. It's that impact that changes somebody else's life.
Sounds like a legacy to me. This is a legacy. You are an iconic man.
But he's still building it.
Everything happens to line up in accordance to, you know, what should fall next and how everything should go.
But is it?
Yes.
That's the question, right? I mean, I think that we make it every day. You know, whatever we want to happen, whatever we envision, it starts with a little thought. And then we keep it in mind to make that change happen.
It is.
And then we put it into action.
You believe in what you want to do, you will get what you want.
Right.
I've got a small little story, you know, and I know if I'm talking too much, you guys will tell me. But you always learn from older people, and you must always remember that. You know, I always say, it's not about the technology and the cleverness and that every generation is cleverer than the next generation. I think my little boy of 6 years knows more about iPad than I do, because this generation, I know more about Matchbox cars and model trains. You know, you don't know anything about stuff like that. But you can always, the experience that I have over you is 25 years.
Absolutely.
You can never, never get it from me,
yeah.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
And my best friend is Roger, who's 70. But you learn from older people, because he can tell me, you know what, when you're going to get older, your prostate is going to start giving you trouble. He won't stop. And you go like, really? And he said, yeah, take it or not, but remember that day when it gets there. And that's what I say to you guys as well, is now if you put that dream out there, the dreams come back to you. I started my life as I'm a woodwork teacher and a metalwork teacher, actually. And then I built my life. I had two restaurants as well. But I said to my wife at that point, I said, you know what? I was driving an old a Chevy truck. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, poor, you know, you work hard in life. You don't have anything. And I said to her, when I come home with an Alfa, do you guys know what's an Alfa?
Uh-huh,
it's
yeah.
an Italian car. It's like the Ferraris, but it's a much cheaper version. It's a, but make any decision. Let's do something that you, we'll say a Chef Corvette in America.
Oh,
yeah.
a two-seater, like cherry apple red.
Yeah.
Oh,
something yeah. small, you know, a cheap, like
those
a sports
nice,
car.
Though.
A sports car, you know. And she said, it will never happen. And you know, like 2 years later, I arrived with the car.
Uh-huh.
And I said, yeah, because, you know, that's the dream that I wanted to show you. And that's what, if you dream things and you put it out there, you can make it,
right.
you can make a difference.
So Riley was once talking to me about the law of attraction, right? And I think the law of attraction doesn't work without the law of action.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But you have to put it in your mind first and keep it in your mind. And then your actions will just occur because you've been so focused on it. In the right environment to create whatever you want to create,
yeah.
it'll happen.
Well, like I heard Jim Carrey say once, you can't just think something and then go eat a sandwich. Once you think of something, inevitably, if you want that bad, then inevitably your actions will bring about reactions. And, you know, if you're pursuing something, you will get whatever that something is as long as you're pursuing it. And that's all it takes.
It's
because
hard work.
The universe gives you everything that you need as long as you're going there. Everything that you need to be successful or whatever it is already exists.
Mm-hmm.
So it's about putting yourself into that bubble of existence as opposed to creating it. It's already created.
Yeah,
the things that you need, you know, the things we needed to fly a plane, the Wright brothers, all of the materials were already there. They just needed to find out how to put that together.
How to put it together.
You know?
Yeah.
And
they worked really hard.
I listened to
yeah.
I don't know.
It was hard work, too. Yeah. Stay in school, yeah.
Well, I don't know if you guys ever heard of, like, Bob Proctor, like the Proctor Gallery or whatever it's called. He's, you know, a huge speaker with law of attraction. I listen to a lot
like
of Bob.
He's, motivational,
Proctor.
Like, inspirational.
Yeah, and there's different types of motivational, more...
Right.
But I don't know. I really believe in that.
The thing about change... is that you have to implement it. change doesn't mean anything unless you add that action verb to it. You know what I mean?
Right.
And the thing about change is change doesn't ever actually exist because it's always changing. Whatever you're trying to change is in motion. So
yeah. It's
something like every atom in your body is always vibrating. Like you could never sit absolutely still.
Right, because everything's in a constant state of motion. There's
yeah.
nothing. There's no such thing as
life moves so fast.
Yeah. And so it's all about finding that vibrations of whatever you're searching for.
Because
you're on a certain vibration, and whatever you want is on a different vibration, and you can match those two frequencies.
I have a final question for
okay,
you.
Okay, final question.
All right, so I'm 23. Seth just turned 24 yesterday.
Starting to get
old.
Oh,
happy birthday.
Starting to get old. 24 is a big 24,
yeah. Riley's 23, right?
23.
Okay, when you were 23.
Yeah.
When you turned 24, how about that? What were you doing?
I was very naughty, man.
You knew he's not naughty. He's not naughty at 24, man. You know.
What do you? Hold on. Let's clarify. Let's clarify. When you say naughty,
naughty,
having a good time.
Explain.
I can assume that by your saying that you weren't weren't in a relationship.
No,
no. So you're single. You're a single young man, South Africa.
Yeah, playing rugby.
Playing rugby.
Very good rugby.
Sweating all the cheer. Is there cheerleaders in rugby?
No, there's a cheerleader, but there's good cheerleaders afterwards.
Okay.
Oh,
good afterwards, good beers.
Yeah.
Okay.
Fun. I just finished university, so I just finished army. Army was just done. So because in South Africa we had to do 2 years of army as well. So I did 4 years at university, did another year, and then went to the army, became a lieutenant in the army, and I got out of that. So now I was a free man for a year because I got married a year later, which was very stupid. Yeah, what did I do? We didn't have all this stuff. We had movies and we had lots of fun, man. Yeah, the computers,
yeah.
You know, computers just came out at that point.
Mm-hmm.
So we had the Pentium 1s. I mean, that thing was so slow. If you put it on, it goes, and you look at the screen, it takes like 5 minutes, and it got some DOS coming up. I mean, that's where this stuff started with us. We got the cell phones at that point, and we started laughing. But we had lots of fun. I had an old Fiat.
Nice.
My friend had a Citroen, and we had fun, you know. We drove around. We drank a lot. We smoked a lot. And just enjoy life. I've always enjoyed my life. I believe that. I think I was brought up so poor, and I made a decision at the age of 5 that I want to be something in life. And yeah, my whole life I enjoy life. I like to meet people, like to see places. You know, I travel the world as much as I could, and I usually have a backpack at that point as well. But I would go to Paris, and I will walk Paris with my backpack. I stayed in London for a year with a pair, and I walked that off. I mean, I've got a lot of stories. So I had a good fun time when I was young. There wasn't politics and pressure and nonsense. It's like being, you know what's so funny? It's I feel like today in America for me. I actually feel 25 now, to tell you the truth.
That's amazing.
That's awesome.
Because
that's
I'm starting a new life at the age of 50. What's wonderful, and everybody will tell you, your brain, and you were going to tell me this in 50 years, your brain never gets old.
Mm.
How can your brain get old? But the body gets old. Mm. And it's always, you know, if a person decides he wants to go old, of course you'd be old, you know? I don't want to be old.
Right.
I don't, my brain says I can't be old. I want to enjoy life. So I'm 50 now, so I'm actually 25. So I'm actually at the same place as you are.
No.
You guys was just teaching more about technology.
I've heard my father say that. I didn't.
50's and 25.
No, I've heard my father. Say, I've heard my father say that your mind never gets older.
Never. My
it's all
was
about
19.
Perspective.
Yeah.
Your body gets older, but your mind is always.
Mind, yeah, until we get completely crazy.
Yeah.
But
and of course, if you have your head on your shoulder,
I'm
already crazy.
You
learn
it. People just increase.
Right. Just go all crazy.
Well, that's it. Riaan, it was awesome to have you on the podcast. We have a lot to reconsider and to continue thinking about. I don't think any of us here expected anything that we learned today, and I want to thank you for sharing that. And I think it's awesome what you're doing. I'm glad that we're friends now, and we're going to get to hang out and maybe do some entrepreneurial stuff.
Yeah.
So be on the lookout in the future for Riaan's creation, right?
Yeah.
And I don't think you can come back and do this again.
I would love to do this. I mean,
do
if
more
we
and more.
Can do stories, if people will see if there's any people that want, we can do stories about wildlife. We can bring Michelle in.
Yeah.
We can have fun, man.
Yeah,
and we can tell you lovely stuff. We can bring a camera in later on for people. We can show them.
Well, next
stuff
time
we
I would suggest maybe next time we do another an extra hour and a half. I mean, an extra half hour. So
right.
We do a full hour, you know, or an hour.
I think in the
minutes.
Future we could definitely do a video, like
yeah.
you were saying.
Oh, yeah.
So it's like, you know, you've got your audio segment and then you got your video
yes.
segment, and then you know. Wherever it takes us, that's awesome.
Yeah.
If anybody out there is looking to get into woodworking or just learning technical skills, building things, even if you're just trying to do it for an event, right? Riaan will help you with that process.
Yeah.
And learning how to build and, you know, have physical, tangible skills.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Thanks again.
I just want to thank you just for the insight, just in general.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it makes me feel blessed, like you said, Ethan, obviously at the end of the day, but I don't realize it every day when I live my life, and it's just, it brings a positive, enlightening feeling, and I really
good.
Appreciate that.
Good.
It's good to be friends.
Yeah, yeah. It gives us like a rejuvenated
yeah.
gratitude.
I feel pumped.
Feeling.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'm 15 all over again.
Yeah, so guys, thank you for, it was lovely to be here, and it's nice to chat.
Thank you.
And yeah, so for everybody out there, you've got a beautiful country. Enjoy every day of it, and God bless America as the president.
Hey, tonight's show marks the third time that we've selected one of their recordings as our Shindig Pick of the Week. And when you hear this one, I'm sure you're going to agree there really was no other choice besides Unchained Melody by Bobby Hatfield of the Righteous Brothers.
Whoa. My love, my darling, I've hungered for your touch a long, lonely time. In time goes by so slowly, and time can do so much. All you still more. Speed your love to me. Lonely rivers flow to the sea, to the open arms of the sea. Wait for me, I'll be coming home, wait for me.